We are heading towards the end of a season as far as Lamborghini Super Trofeo Europe is concerned. We're at Barcelona and there are two races here before we have the final two at another Iberian circuit in November. We go to Portimao for the final weekend of Super Trofeo, not just Europe, but also North America. And that weekend as well will be the world finals competition. So points scored here are important for the four championships. We have a Pro-Am class. We have the AMS and the Lamborghini Cup as well for the less experienced drivers. And this promises to be a really good race. It's a busy, big grid. The fans out in force to see Valentino Rossi, who is here for GT3 duties, but they're going to be entertained right royally, that's for sure, by Lamborghini Super Trofeo. The grid is based on the times that were set in qualifying this morning. The championships, of which, as I say, there are the four with the different classes being led as far as, for example, Pro-Am is concerned, by Massimo Siglia and Lewis Williamson. They currently are on 109 points of the 85 of Oscar Lee and Dan Wells. The AMs are being led by Stefan Guérin. He's only 3 points ahead of Gabriel Rendoni. In Lamborghini Cup, 20 points separates Gerard van der Horst from the Privitello father and son, Luciano and Donovan Privitello. But in Pro, it is almost a runaway for Loris Spinelli and Max Wearing, 120 points to the 83 of Amaury Vandewel. Now, as far as overall is concerned, this is how the championship looks. It is Wearing and Spinelli ahead of Vandewel, and then Lewis Williamson and Massimo Giglia come next. But those are points scored from the overall positions, whereas there are these class rewards to look for as well. So down on the grid, the cars with the doors open to try and get a bit of air in. Even though it's autumn in Barcelona, it's still got a warm day. Lots of people in their shorts and t-shirts. And number 66 is the Bronic Formanet car. Let's go to Gemma Scott on the grid first of all.
Max, pole, and an impressive time that Loris put in there, half a second quicker.
Loris did an amazing job, even that it's quite difficult to put out a great time on the track at the moment. It's so busy, 44 cars on the track, but he found a gap on the track and he did an amazing job, so I'm happy with that. And yeah, we just have to finish it up again for this weekend. I hope we can take a P1 and then we are getting close to the championship.
Absolutely, we've certainly dominated this season. Just quickly, we've just seen the GT3s out on track and they're talking about how difficult the grip is here with the heat, and it is feeling quite hot. Is that going to be a challenge for you guys?
It's a big challenge. The drop of the tires is really, really big. The first three laps it's okay, but after that the drop is really big. So we have to figure out how to get the car on its best till the end of the race. But we'll figure out how we're doing it, so we'll be fine.
I'm sure we'll see you at the end. Thanks,
Thank
Max.
Thank you.
So it's been an impressive start to the season for Max Wearing. He was quick last year, but when Loris Spinelli was brought in as his co-driver to help him win a championship, he became even faster. Stefan Guérin there, one of the leading lights within the AM contest. Stefan Guérin, who has had victories this season, two in the AM contest, and he is the AM championship leader. There's a very full grid. Some cars still being pushed into position, as you've just heard, 44 cars, and Loris Spinelli is the man that will start at the front. It's a race with mandatory pit stops, and the cars serve the stop between the 20th and 30th minutes, and also they are done to a time, 86 seconds. Let's hear next from Marzio Moretti. He lines up on the outside of row one.
Moretti, obviously the pole position time was significantly faster than everybody else on the grid, but that's not necessarily reflective of what's going to happen here in the race. What's the objective?
Well, obviously we are here to go as fast as possible and beat our competitors. That's for every race. We know we have a competitive package because we got second and first place in the two qualifying sessions, so we know we are very fast, both of us, both Milan and I. So we are a competitive duo, the car setup is great, and now we hope we can manage the tires and get a good race going.
And of course, with such a big grid, prime spot on the front row.
Exactly. It's great to be in front of so many people. The spectacle will be very good, but we need to be aware of back markers as well.
Just final question. Do you like the circuit?
It's the first time I drive here, actually. I've never been in Barcelona, and my first time was in Friday. But the track is great, I have to say. It's very fun to drive, but also very technical.
Thank you very much. Have a good one.
Thank you.
So Baggio Moretti will do the second stint, and Milan Tikkens, who has also been a race winner this year, he and Mattia Moretti have celebrated a victory together. He will do the start stint. And further down on the grid, you've got the Yuri Wagner-driven Lipert run car from the AM contest. That lines up on the grid. And Yuri Wagner, again, a driver to look for within his class here, because the class positions are what many of them are going to be concentrating on. So number 97, Yuri and Louis Wagner. And it's Yuri that will go first in that car. So there is the grid. Very shortly, it will be cleared. We've still got cars being pushed into place. In a sense, it doesn't really matter because it's a rolling start anyway. They've got that formation lap, but everybody needs to be roughly where they ought to be. Part of it means that, yes, at the moment there's a row that's looking a little bit higgledy-piggledy, but that's being put right, as their number 91 is the car of Pietro Parolini and Barolo Biglieri, lining up 11th on the grid, and it is Pietro Parolini who will go first. So Loris Spinelli for pole position, Milan Tikkens with him on the second row, Martin Kodrich and Lewis Williamson. There on the fifth row, number 10, that is Milan Petelet, who has a different co-driver from Dmitry Gavatsova, who he started the year with. That is Philippe Châtelet, that he will be sharing that car with. And it's Milan Petelet who will start. Number 10 there is solo driver Rodrigo Testa de Sousa for the Rexel FFF racing team. Ninth on the grid, another of the cars out of the pro category. And because he's a soloist, he will make a pit stop of a further 3 seconds just to try to balance out the advantage that you gain by going solo, because you know what the track conditions are like when you get back into the stint. Another soloist here is Amaury Bonduelle, who won the second race at Spa in his BDR competition run entry. And Emanuele Zonzini for VSR is going to start in the car that he shares with Emmanuel Colombini. So from the inside of the fourth row, Zonzini, seventh quickest this morning, he will go first. And that car has also had one win within Pro-Am. Go forward a row, and a car that's been desperately unlucky this year, that of Jean-Luc Darrier and the start driver Stefan Tribodini, coming up from GT4 ranks, these two into Super Trofeo this year. But a lot of bad luck has gone their way. And new to the championship is the Lamborghini Stuttgart by Target entry that's driven by Lennart Marionetsch. But Daniel Karlwitz, former German GT champion, we've seen him in Fanatec GT in the past. Very, very quick driver is Daniel Karlwitz. He perhaps doesn't know Lamborghinis all that well yet, but he's certainly going to be a man to watch. As also here is Lewis Williamson in the Oregon team entry that he shares with Massimo Ciglia. And that car lines up fourth on the grid in the oh-so-distinctive and familiar Oregon colours. It was Oregon that won the championship last year. Third on the grid for Bonaldi Motorsport, Martin Kodrich will go first in the car that he shares with Sandro Mur. Martin Kodrich, who along with Dennis Lind was, as it was then called, Blancpain GT Series Asia champion a good few years back. And Martin Kodrich, race winner in British GT with Hunter Abbott. Very quick driver, one to watch in the opening stint. Milan Tikkens then starting second on the grid. Yet another driver to watch. We've got so many good quality drivers in the championship this year. It's great to see Milan Tikkens for Target Racing. And then the pole position car is going to be that of Loris Spinelli. He will go first and certainly will be looking to try to build the lead, ready for that to be preserved by Max Wiering. Max is quick, but not as quick, going into the second stint. So the grid now is being cleared. And as the mechanics make their way off the grid, very shortly the signal will be given, and then the formation lap can get underway. So the Lamborghini Urus accelerates away. It will go towards turn one, and then after a suitable interval,
green flag.
The instruction from the race director you hear in the background, Alain Adon, will release the cars, and they blast away. So down towards turn one, they now turn. Great noise these cars make, of course. And in the case of some of the Pro-Am entries, there's always that fascination of seeing what the pros can do relative to the pace of the Ams. Loris Spinelli then will start on pole position with Milan Tikkens lining up alongside. The second row of the grid, Martin Kodrich and Lewis Williamson to line up alongside him. On the third row of the grid, Daniel Karlowitz and Stefan Tribodini. And row four is where you find Emanuele Zonzini and Amaury Bonduel. Row five, Rodrigo Testa de Souza lines up with Milan Petelet for Target Racing, the company. Then there is Pietro Perolini for Bernaldi and aboard the Liebherr car alongside Jean-Francois Bruno. On the seventh row of the grid, it is the Dan Wells but Oscar Lee started Rexel FFF Racing Team entry alongside Yuri Wagner, Stefan Gerrard and Gabriele Rindoni share row eight. Row nine is going to be Karol Bash and Andre Lewandowski, who have shared a car in the past together. They now line up alongside each other. Sebastian Freimuth is on the next row of the grid with Martin Reiber alongside him. Then it is Adrian Lewandowski and Raf Mikrut will go first in the GT3 Poland car ahead of Cedric Lima, and then Gerhard Batzinger for Leipert is going to be alongside. On the 13th row, Claude-Yves Gosselin and Diego Locanto. On the 14th row, Holger Harmsen lines up with Cyril Lima for company ahead of Antonios Vossos, and then another of the Oregon team cars, this for Alessandro Tarabini. Eddie Dubeli comes next with lining up alongside Damian Chosek. Gerard van der Horst has David Mihai Serban alongside him. On the 18th row, there is Artus Batrax and a returning Shota Abkhabalza, the Georgian driver. The 19th row is senior Freimuth, Oliver Freimuth. Francois Grimm will line up alongside him ahead of Hans Fabry and Daniel Vashinsky. On the 21st row is the Luciano and Donovan Privitelio car, which should be started by Luciano Privitelio, but the graphic says Donovan, but I suspect that's a transponder in the wrong place. But alongside will be Jose Alfredo Hernandez Ortega, and the back row, Kurt Wagner and Kumar Prabhakaran, the Malaysian driver. That rounds out a 44-strong grid, which is a fantastic entry. One of the biggest I think we've ever had for Super Trofeo Europe. It means that it's going to be a busy old race, this. And 50 minutes of action is about to get underway then as the cars come down towards turn 13. There, 87, which is the Liebherr car of Jean-Francois Bruno, missing from the sixth row of the grid. So that car is going to have to start, obviously, from the pits and therefore last. So it gives up 12th. Basically, it missed the pit lane closing. Cars were trying to do an extra lap to the grid and it couldn't get out in time. So that car starts then from the pits. Its progress will be interesting once we get underway. So down they come into turn 15. The pace car, as it is, peels into the pit lane, and then it's up to the front row drivers to control the pace. There they come past the grandstand on pole position. That is Loris Spinelli, who accelerates away as the lights go to green. He gets a good drop on the opposition then as they thunder down towards turn one. So Loris Spinelli, it is in the lead of the race with, trying to slot in behind him there, Milan Tikkens. But is he going to get mugged on the inside line? Having a go is Martin Kodrich, and Kodrich breaks as late as he dares and he goes through. So Kodrich goes second. Lewis Williamson is fourth as they go through turns one and two. This first pinch point, going too deep, run wide, get over the curb, and you start to lose ground, lose places as the field is still sweeping its way up through turn three for the first time. Out of the pits to join the race, Jean-Francois Bruno right at the back. So the progress of that car will be now worth monitoring, as there on the outside line is Stefan Tribodini for BSR, being forced out wide and losing ground as a result, as the cars now drop down towards turn five. Tribodini through on the inside there, picks up the place at the expense of Daniel Karlowitz, and drama at the back of the pack. Somebody's been tagged and turned around. Trying to identify who that is, but for the moment, answer comes there none. We'll try to unravel it all as the course of the lap unwinds now. So from his pit lane start, Jean-Francois Bruno is on the attack, but from pole position, Loris Spinelli doing what you anticipate him to do, and that is to try and get away from the rest and build that gap. Down at turn 10, efforts are being made by some, Tribodini amongst them, to gain ground, but the race leader, Loris Spinelli, is a good six lengths, if not more, clear. Coming under attack there, further back. Another spinner out of turn 10, look. and cars scatter in avoidance. Again, try to identify in the distance who that is, but it's rather broken up the pack as they try and sweep round the outside there. Now, one car that's been turned around is number 63, so Cedric Lima in strife, because he has not yet got to the end of the middle sector, and that incident has happened in sector 3 and 55, we understand. Adrian Lewandowski is the one that's been turned around up at turn 10, so that car hopefully can get going. The leader goes through then. Loris Spinelli, 2.5 seconds clear at the end of the first lap from Martin Kodrich. Milan Tikkanen's in third place, and that's the reason it's not going very far. Lewandowski's car has got a punctured tyre. He's tried to turn it round and get out of the way, but there's a puncture. It might even be suspension damage, and I can sniff a safety car coming here to try to get that out of harm's way. Lima has rejoined after his spin. Yellows are in sector 3 then, and up front it is Spinelli from Kodrich, 1 and 2. But 2.5 seconds in the space of a lap rather illustrates the point as to why Spinelli is a gun for hire in Lamborghini terms, and people want him as the quick co-driver in Super Trofeo. Daniel Karlovits there, trying to fend off Emmanuel Zonzini. That battle is on for sixth place. Karlovits new to the car. Zonzini dives up the inside, can't quite do it as they get to turn 7. Karlovits forced out a little bit wide there, up the curb, back onto the racetrack, and Zonzini is all over him like a rash now, isn't he, as they get up towards turn 9. Turn the corner, wait to see what's the other side of the brow. And this is what's the other side of it, the straight down towards turn 10 and a yellow flag zone. Yellow flag to wave, and it is only a local yellow because of that car for the moment, but the race director might have other ideas. Yep, he does. Safety car is deployed. Safety car is going to scoop them up.
Safety car procedure.
Safety car is called for then by the race director, Alain Adom. So not only will they slow down, but also, of course, that will cost Spinelli his race lead. In terms of a gap, I should say. He's not going to lose the place, but he's going to lose all the time that he built up. So 2.6 seconds, give or take, at the end of lap one. He's going to disappear, and it brings Martin Kodrich and it brings Milan Tikkanen back into the mix as well as they come over the timing line there. So this is the view from Spinelli's car, but behind, the clear real estate that he built up now disappears. It shouldn't take long, one would have thought, to drag Lewandowski's car out of the way, but it does need removing before we can get the race back underway. Now it's up to Loris Spinelli to try to keep the tyre pressures up, keep the tyre temperatures up. Replay of the start. It was a very good getaway from Loris Spinelli as he went accelerating down towards the first corner. And Martin Kodrich also a good start to get himself level with perhaps a slower starting Milan Tikkanen, and he dived through, so Kodrich up into second place, but wasn't long before things got busy and messy in the middle of the pack. And as I say, 63, which is the car of Cyril Lima, was the first one that got turned around. And did he do it with any help? No, it just seemed to snap away from him as he turned in. The car on cold tyres seemed to break traction there, so looked as though Lima did it on his own. And the same is true of Adrian Lewandowski. Around he went, all self-induced, and then, unless he'd had an earlier tag, which is where the puncture came from, but the Levenpol backed car towed out of the way, and as soon as the road is clear, then we'll be back racing. It's nearly 5 kilometres long, this circuit, so under safety car speeds, you don't lose many laps. You ease into the time of the race, admittedly, but you're not doing lap after lap under the safety car. So as soon as possible, things will be back underway. It depends really where the Lewandowski car can be towed to. There it is. Look out of the front of the leader's car, and the next vehicle access point is what they're aiming for, but that car, as yet, still needs to finish the recovery operation. So it'll be maybe one more lap behind the safety car here. Lights on when they are extinguished. That's the indication that we will be going green to get things back underway. Class leaders at the end of the first lap. Well, obviously, the overall leader leads Pro, Loris Spinelli. Martin Kodrich leads Pro-Am. Am is Andre Lewandowski. And the Lamborghini Cup, a long way back, Francois Grimm. Number 31 is the class leader there.
Safety car in this lap. Safety car in this lap.
So the race director confirms that we will go racing this time. Alain Adon, who has taken over control of the Lamborghini Super Trofeo Europe this year. And he will, now that the road is clear, get the safety car to speed up a little bit so that the drivers have a chance to get more temperature in tyres. I've got to say, it's a pretty strung out lap, actually, because although Loris Spinelli is right on the tail of the safety car, as you look at cars here going through turn four, some have just gone out of the last corner, just past my window on the start-finish straight. So as out of turn five comes the pack, the leading pack, the stragglers have got quite a bit of catching up to do. Progress, by the way, of Jean-Francois Bruno from the pit lane. Well, 44 started, 43 circulate. He's the 40th of them. In a way, this helps him because he can play catch-up as long as the traffic ahead catches up. If they're straggling, then it doesn't help him very much at all. He might be able to gain a few places, but he needs one long line of cars to make really good progress. Whereas, as I say, they are still at the back, quite strung out. But we will go racing this time. And coming out of turn 10, the La Caixa left-hander. So Loris Spinelli backs the pack up, starts to bunch them all up behind, ready to floor the throttle. Now, where does he choose to do it? Will it be coming into or out of the chicane? Or is he going to leave it to the very, very last corner? Martin Kodrić on his tail. Yes, it's a battle on track between them, but it's not going to be a battle that the number 32 car of Martin Kodrić can sustain, because his co-driver, Sandro Müller, new to racing this year, won't be able to be as quick in the second stint. Green flag wave. We go back racing now. So the green flag shown, and Loris Spinelli storms out of turn 15, up towards the timing line, race back on, goes through, goes over the line, and now into turn one. So it is Loris Spinelli that leads the way from Martin Kodrić and Milan Tikkens in third place. Lewis Williamson, regular in this, as well as helping James Cottingham in British GT this year, runs fourth and there through on the inside line. Number 66, that's Carol Bash, sharing this weekend with Bronek Formanek, and Carol Bash making progress ahead of his previous co-driver, Andrei Lewandowski. So the leaders are at turn four. Just going over the line, a little further back, is the car in 41st place, that of Jose Hernandez Ortega. So you get a feel for where the Lamborghini Cup entrants have dropped to relative to the drivers in the pro class. So Loris Spinelli now tries to rebuild that lead over Martin Kodrić in second place. Milan Tikkens runs third. Daniel Kalwitz still trying to fend off Emmanuel Zonzini for sixth place. And Stefan Tribodini, who's had all sorts of bad luck this year, mechanical and incident-induced, he is running ahead of that pair in fifth position. So effectively, we've got another 10 minutes before the window opens, and a challenge is made there by number 24, which is the Oliver Freimuth entry. Freimuth to the inside line. He's another experienced one-mate racer, is Oliver Freimuth. His son Sebastian is in the race as well. Freimuth now tries to fend off the car of Artūrs Batrex. New to the championship is the Latvian driver, and more battles rage on further down the order as well. In the midst of which is Luciano Privitelio. Number 11 goes through there. The Oregon entry of Alessandro Tarabini. The race leaders go through, and an incident involving number 9, which is Milan Petelet, and 51 Oscar Lee, is under investigation at turn 5 from earlier on in the race. So the stewards going to have a look at that. The rest of the field pulls over the line then. So Spinelli, you can anticipate to stay out for a reasonable amount of that window to try to give Max Wearing the best possible chance. They're going through. Number 13 is the Stefan Gerrand car. He's just got himself ahead of Sebastian Freimuth. So these two squabble away. But Sebastian Freimuth, who drove in the World Finals event last year at Misano, coming back then at Stefan Gerrand, another GT4 graduate. Almost like a wave of people have come into the championship from GT4 and French GT. Battle on here. Milan Petelet still trying to fend off Carol Bash. Nose to tail they run. Carol Bash, Italian GT champion, has made a real name for himself in Lamborghinis. Ex-Clio racer tries to get up on the inside line there in the red car. But the door is closed, so Milan Petelet fends him off. Petelet, somebody else that we've seen quite a lot of in things like Carrera Cup France, as well as GT4. and in Lamborghini, doing a good job here, fending off the more experienced Super Trofeo racer, the Polish driver Karol Bash. There is a 10-second time penalty to be given to car number 9, which is Milan Petelet, for causing a collision. So 10-second time penalty for Milan Petelet. We'll factor that in at the end of the race. So the race leader, Loris Spinelli, pushes on. Number 9, there he is, that's Milan Petelet. Who's on the back at the moment of number 91, which is Pietro Perolini's car, out of the chicane. So at the moment, Petelet is trying to attack, trying to defend, and he also needs to try, with the help of his co-driver in the second stint, to overcome that 10-second penalty. Philippe Châtelet is going to have to do the hard yards in the second stint to try to pull that time back. No surprise that Loris Spinelli has set the fastest lap of the race. And his margin over Martin Kodrich now is 2.2 seconds. So there is Spinelli. Three turns again. Martin Kodrich runs second, Milan Tietgens runs third, and then Lewis Williamson fourth. Now, Williamson to Kodrich is a battle to look for, or perhaps more appropriately, in the second stint, Sandro Mir to Massimo Ciglia is the battle, because they are 1 and 2 within Pro-Am at the moment. Fourth and second, Williamson fourth, Kodrich second in stint one. Challenge made there on the inside line, but this time it's the outside that pays dividends for Sebastian Freimuth, and he goes through ahead now of the car of Stefan Gerhardt, so he's gone through up into 15th place, Sebastian Freimuth. So lap 7, race leaders come out of turn 10. In fact, the leader is already up at turn 12. The kink is 11 as you climb the hill and then loop round 12. This is turn 10, where the back markers are coming through and out a little bit wide there goes 91 then. So Perolini forced out wide. Karol Bash gets through, gets the job done going up towards turn 12. So Bash has got past Petelet and now gets up past Perolini as well. Pietro Perolini falls back. So Karol Bash having a good lap and therefore bringing that car for Bronek Fomanek further up the order going into the second part of the race. Downhill he dropped once more through that right-hander that brings him onto the pit straight up towards the timing line. So Karol Bash running in Pro-Am in the Michinek Motorsport ACCR entry goes through now into the top 10. Next target is Rodrigo Testa de Sousa. Further back, Andrei Lewandowski still leads in Am and in Lamborghini Cup at the moment, Francois Grimm. That's Martin Kodrich leading the Pro-Am contest for Bonaldi. So the Croatian driver comes through. Sandro Mir, the entrepreneur that's in his first season of racing, will take over that car. And Sandro Mir won't match Kodrich's pace, but he's got a lot quicker over the course of his season. Remember, these are all double-header events, and this is the fifth of the sixth double-header rounds that we have had. They've been to Imola, they have been to Paul Ricard, then to Misano, and of course Spa. Andrei Lewandowski, the leading Am in the VSR car, Vincenzo Sospiri Racing. And Lewandowski has made something of a habit of winning titles, whether it's been on his own or with a co-driver, whether it's been in Pro-Am or Am, whether it's been in the championship or the world finals over the years. But he's an accomplished driver, had a rather nasty exit at Misano last year when a brake failure put him off the road, but he's bounced back from that in good order. There, Lewis Williamson then, the quick Brit, another ex-single-seater and GT racer, had a few years away. He's come back now to kickstart his career in British GT and Super Trofeo. But if you think back a few years, he was part of the Straka Racing squad in the SRO Endurance Series. Over the timing line he goes, chasing after Milan Tietgens. So the car that was on the outside of the front row is now very nearly 6 seconds away from the race leader. And we're 4 minutes away from that window opening for the pit stops. So the leaders turn through. Onto lap number 9, Loris Spinelli it is, still clear up front. And as the rest of the field drops down towards turn 1, you can see this long, long line of cars. At the back of the pack is Kumar Prabhakaran, the Malaysian driver who we've seen in the Asian Championship, that for the moment not running because of the restrictions on travel in certain parts of the region. So he's doing his racing in Europe, and he's a very welcome addition to the grid. As they're going through, number 18 is the Lipat car of David Mihai Serban, the Romanian. He's one of the Lamborghini factory young drivers. He's part of that young driver program, and coming into this championship this year at the moment. Serban, fair way down the order, work to be done to haul that car back into the mix on the pit stops. But 25th he runs, and he has just got ahead of Antonios Vossos, so a place has been gained. So Loris Spinelli leads the way by nearly 3 seconds. He's done the fastest lap of the race, as there through is number 87. That is Jean-Francois Bruno that made the pit lane start and is up into 34th place. So he's gained effectively 10 positions. And when Kieron Lee, his co-driver, gets into the car for the second stint, he will have to carry on this charge. So there, out of the chicane, Milon Petelet under attack then. But as they come down through turn 15, he has finally done it to get ahead of Pietro Perolini. So through goes Petelet, gains the place that he's been working so hard for against Perolini. And as they dive down towards the first corner now, the lead gap continues to hover about the 2.5 second mark. Now, Petelet, with this penalty, has got to pull clear. And this is how it all happened. It was a mistake made by Perolini. He ran wide, and that gave the opportunity to dive through. Milon Petelet took it, and you don't often see moves being made in that fashion into the chicane, but it worked for Petelet, helped though by an error from the car in front. Into turn four comes the pack now. Now, when we get to the pit stops, just looking ahead, they are a minute and 26 seconds, plus an extra 3 for the soloists. Perolini, I think, is going to come under more attack now, because Andrei Lewandowski, the leading AM, is closing all the time. Drop downhill now. And then as you keep dropping, look left, your heart sinks, there's another climb. So out of turn seven, a sideways Perolini then flicks the car up the hill, which is a steep old climb there. And then as you get to turn nine, over the brow, and it's only as you come out of the corner that you can see over the crest and know what's the other side of it. So as you're turning blind. Here, though, battle is on, and this is for third place. Milan Tietgens versus Lewis Williamson. Drop down now into the chicane, and the pit window will be open at the end of the next lap for these cars. Some of the back markers might even be able to do it this time, and there's one car slow down to the chicane. So as the leader comes through, Loris Spinelli, there is the car in strife. And 72 it is, which therefore means it's Kumar Prabhakaran. Now, I think he's getting out of the way of the quicker cars because he doesn't want to be in their way at the chicane. So by slowing right down and getting off the road even, Kumar Prabhakaran makes certain that he doesn't impede anybody. The leaders go through, and the lead gap, 2.5 seconds, Spinelli to Kodrich. In real terms, it is Milan Tietgens that we need to be keeping an eye on before he hands the car over to Marzio Moretti. And what Moretti can do relative to Max Wearing will be the question, as wriggling out of the chicane, number 11, that is Alessandro Tarabini, ex-Clio Cup Europe racer. Number 39 hustles up the inside line there. Shota Alcazava, the Georgian motorsport impresario. Good to have him back racing. He's owned circuits, raced cars, run championships, owned teams, you name it. And he's been a great supporter of this championship over the years. And off the road there, through the gravel and back on again, has gone. Let's see. Was that the leader? Or was that Perolini? It was Perolini, wasn't it? Number 91. So the Bonaldi car of Pietro Perolini, off the road and back on again. It's cost him time. So having already lost out once to Petelet, gets dive bombed there and just runs off the road, as also does Yuri Wagner. So both of them braked as late as they could. Possibly Wagner was gauging his braking against Perolini, but that's two mistakes that Perolini has made. The pit window, as you see, is now open, and we've got cars from the rear of the field making their mandatory stops now. So in some cases, it's to get it out of the way. In other cases, it is to do the driver change. But one of the joys of this championship, of course, is that you can have a solo or a double driver entry. The leaders go by, and that now means that Spinelli is 2.8 seconds ahead of Martin Kodrich. The gap between them is widening a touch. In third place, Milan Tietgens goes through. Lewis Williamson not really being able to take the fight to him, but equally get the feeling now that Lewis Williamson is quite happy just to win the class in the second stint, knowing that they've got the quicker car than Kodrich and Sandro Merz is likely to be. Daniel Kajlwitz then still strong in fifth, but a little bit further back, and then sixth, Stefan Tribodini. So who out of that leading group will be the first one to come for the mandatory pit stops? In has just come Martin Reiber, the Slovakian, to give way to Eduardo Liberati. That'll be a quick car with Liberati behind the wheel, but Loris Spinelli is the race leader for Bonaldi, and he will give the car to Max Wiering. They, remember, are the class leaders in pro. And with 120 points to 83, plus now a point for pole position, it's looking good for them. This is Kodrich heading pro-am, doing his best to stay with the leading car, and in fact a tenth quicker within the first sector of this lap. Milan Tikkanen's third, and Lewis Williamson, having suggested that he might be content to sit there and wait for the pit stops and just do the work in pro-am in the second stint. Maybe not. He's coming back, isn't he, at Milan Tikkanen? So the two of them now make that climb up towards turn 12. It's another corner where you've got to be patient, and finally you come out of it and nail the throttle and accelerate down towards turn 13. And that's where we had that mistake from Pietro Perolini a few laps back there. Very wide indeed, the race leader, Loris Spinelli, comes through. Mind you, the same is true also of Martin Kodrich as he comes over the timing line, but too many of those four wheels off, and you're going to incur the wrath of the stewards. So the race leaders then, as there for the pit lane comes Stefan Tribodini. He will give way to Jean-Luc Daria. That's then at the end of lap 12. Race leaders currently on lap 13, and Jean-Luc Daria being installed into the car. Takes over then from Tribodini. So Loris Spinelli's stint has been a very good one indeed. He is now 3.4 seconds to the good over Martin Kodrich in that second spot. In terms of track limits, the only real drama has gone the way of Martin Kodrich. He's had a warning for abusing track limits, but there a challenge is made on the inside line. Through now goes David Serban, picks up a place, gets himself up past Cyril Lima and moves himself through. So bit by bit, he's heading up the order. The Limas have been massive supporters of Lamborghini Super Trofeo, going back to when it had much smaller grids, and they've gone through the Gallardos as well as the Huracans. There, number 66, Carol Bash in eighth place. The order, of course, shuffled now because of the pit stops. And there, going over the white line with two wheels, Jean-Luc Daria. That may end up being looked at, because you shouldn't drive over that white line. You're always told that the white line is a barrier, and if you were to hit a barrier, you'd damage the car. So, you know, treat it as such. Otherwise, you will be damaged with a time penalty. So that, I fear, may put him in strife. And also the pit stop of Elie Dubelli to Pierre Fellegioni is under investigation as well. I'll tell you the reason for that if I can trace the car's pit stop time. Fellegioni is at the wheel, and the pit stop time was 1 minute 24.7, which is under the regulation time. So that's why it's being looked at, because it was too short a pit stop. Right, the pit lane is busy. In has come Andre Lewandowski, in has come Sebastian Freimuth, in has come Pietro Perolini. So the team's busy. There's not much you can do other than affect the driver change, change tire pressures if needs be. But what the real crux of the team work is to make sure when you release the car, it's not going to be under on the pit stop time. They'll work out the delta time, the delta speed, and therefore how long the car needs to be at rest for, so as not to be short on the pit stop. And as you've seen, people can still get it wrong. So number two, which is run by the Boots and Racing team, and a car off there in the gravel up at turn four, that's got an Oregon feel to it. Is that Tarabini, number 11? It is, that car. So in the gravel bed, it's just been taken over, in fact, by Filippo Berto. So Filippo Berto on his out lap, I reckon, is in the gravel. Illustrates one of the reasons why it's sometimes beneficial to be a soloist, because you know exactly what the track is like. Filippo Berto into the car and off he goes. So Filippo Berto off the racetrack. Now, he may have had a bit of help. He had been quick in the first sector, but even so, that car off the road on its first flying lap of the race. So yellow flags are out in sector two, and this might again end up being a safety car to get that out of the way. And that, if it is going to be the case, rather throws out of the window strategy that the different teams have been trying to work on. Milan Petelet in to serve his mandatory stop, by the way, but we have as yet not seen Spinelli in, and if we do go safety car, then that will again really reduce the advantage that he can hand over to Max Wearing. So drivers that are fresh out of the cars walk to the pit wall to go and study the data, see what their car is doing. Into number nine, replacing Milan Petelet, Philippe Châtelet. Though that driver change affected in the Target racing car, Target another of the stalwart teams in Lamborghini Super Trofeo. And the pit lane klaxon working overtime as more and more and more of the 43 surviving cars dive to the pit lane. So Loris Spinelli staying out, but he's going to have to come in pretty soon, probably this time anyway, because I don't think he will be able to squeeze another lap out of the stint. Down to the chicane he comes. He's left it late through 13, 14, 15. Now for pit in, and finds a car right ahead of him as he dived for the pit road there. That was a bit close, wasn't it, as Hans Fabry came to the pit lane as well. And very nearly into the back of him. So Loris Spinelli brakes as late as he dares. Hans Fabry had braked a little bit sooner and oh so nearly contact. But Loris Spinelli rather proving what the pro drivers do, which is go flat out from the moment the race starts to the moment they get to the line at the pit in. That's when you brake, not before. So Spinelli 4 seconds ahead of Kodrić. He was, comes down the pit lane. So he has pushed and pushed and pushed. He's built that lead and down the pit road he now comes. Another driver that's being investigated is number 12, which is Daniel Vashinsky. Speed of car 12 at pit entry under investigation. Right, we are now with 21 minutes of the race to go, and Loris Spinelli handing over to Max Wearing. Others awaiting their cars in the pit lane. So this looks like it's a pretty well-drilled stop from the Bernaldi car. Bernaldi, another of those teams that has been in the championship for season after season after season. Others arrive in the pits, and still we've got that yellow flag in sector two. It might be that once the pit window has closed, we go safety car to get it out of the way rather than interrupt the whole cycle of the pit stops. We'll see what the race director and race direction team decide to do. So the order for the moment shuffles with the pit stops cycling through. Looking there at number six of Jean-Luc Daria. And there, more and more of them leaving the pit lane now. So Max Wearing back on track. Sandro Mir will take over from Martin Kodrić. And Marzio Moretti should take over from Milan Tikkens. I say all of that, although Martin Kodrić's name is still shown alongside number 32, so I'll have to look at lap times to really see whether there has been a driver change there and they just haven't changed the transponder position, because it's down to the teams to do that, not the timekeepers. Number 50 serving its stop. That car driven by Diego Locanto, the Italian. It's another of the Target racing cars, their fleet from the AMP contest. And the pit window about to close. Has closed. So let's see what happens in terms of that stranded car now. So that is the race leader, Max Wearing, trying to get away from the opposition. And Max, relatively inexperienced compared to some, but as I say, drove in the championship last year, was always competitive, but when he had Loris Spinelli to help him late season to try to go for the championship, that's when he really did look good. And he's also raced these cars in America as well as Europe, so he's well versed now in Super Trofeo, and he will lead again coming up now towards the end of lap 16 with just under 19 minutes of the race to go. Still that yellow flag then out in the middle sector. Wearing leads Codrich slash Moore, depending on whether there was or not a driver change. We'll try and get an idea when we look at lap times, but at the moment the sector is suggesting that it's definitely not Martin Codrich at the wheel, even though it's his name still shown as driving the car. Through then goes now Amaury Bonduel, who has taken over the race lead.
Safety car procedure.
And we do go safety car to get the car out of the gravel. So the safety car there is on track. It's missed the leader, but it will have the provision now to wave everybody by and then pick up the leading car. So we've gone safety car, but it might take a little while now to get the right car behind, or indeed for the safety car to overtake and find the race leader. It has the opportunity to do both. So Amaury Bonduel has taken over the race lead, rather unnoticed. Now, where was Amaury Bonduel on the grid? He's been a race winner this year, but he was on the fourth row. But he has done a pit stop of 68.9 seconds as opposed to 86. So that, I suspect, is part of the reason why Amaury Bonduel is ahead, because he hasn't served anything like the regulation pit stop time. So that's going to be looked at by race control. Max Wearing's stop, which should have been 89 seconds, turned out in the end to be a bit slower than that, so they lost a little bit of time in the pit lane relative to some of those around them. Now we have got the recovery crew on hand to get number 11 of Filippo Berto out of the gravel, but yeah, a pit stop for Max Wearing and Loris Spinelli should have been a minute and 26, and it was a minute and 34, so they've lost a big chunk of time, which has brought Marzio Moretti into the pits, into the picture, and then Lennart Marionek, former GT racer, sharing with Daniel Karlowitz there as well. And this safety car is bunching them all up again anyway. Sandro Mer confirmed as having taken over from Codrich. And the safety car goes a-hunting for the race leader, which is now 28 of Amaury Bonduel. That car, I think, has just gone across the line. Oh dear. This has the makings of being a bit messy now. The safety car is on an absolute mission and has just gone hammering past the pits. There's the leader, there's the safety car in the background. And in fairness to Amaury Bonduel, he has done the job absolutely right here. He has slowed right down. The safety car has found him, caught him, and now we're all right. And there, off the road, is Filippo Berto, because he has been hoiked out of the gravel, rejoins, and so the road is clear other than the recovery vehicle getting off the circuit. So Filippo Berto's car is out of the gravel, which is the good news. The road is then clear to go racing once more. And Amaury Bonduel is a notional race leader, because we are anticipating a penalty looming for him. Anybody else under a minute and 26 seconds? Think pretty much everybody. Oh no, there is one, which is, oh yeah, Pierre Ferligioni, we looked at that earlier. So yeah, it is only that one car that is massively short on the pit stop, and by such a margin. A minute and 26, they did a minute and 8. I mean, I don't know how you get it quite so wrong. Anyway, Bonduel surely is going to end up with a big time penalty for that. That'll be going through the system. The data will be provided by Swiss Timing, the timekeeping service. That then goes to the race director, who says to the stewards, there you go, what are you going to do about this? I'm running the race, you're sorting out penalties, and the decision will be made. And of course, the problem now for Bonduel is that he hasn't got much of the race left in which to try to pull out a gap over Max Wearing. Marzio Moretti, though, in third place, he's going to be the other man to watch. He's got a bit of traffic, though, to negotiate, hasn't he? Because ahead of him is Oliver Freimuth, number 24, and he's got to get past Freimuth before he can do anything about the top two. But if Bonduel defends from Wearing whilst Moretti gets through the traffic, then it could be game on. So we've got cars coming over the line, just one or two exiting turn 15, and the safety car is at turn 10. So again, stragglers are numerous in all of this. We've got one line. I mean, it's part of the issue, if you like, of 44 cars on track of differing speeds and abilities and experience levels. But the safety car can't really come in yet because you're going to release the leaders into back markers who are not going at the same sort of speed as the pros would when the race gets underway. So it's going to be at least one more lap, I think, to give some of the back markers not necessarily a chance to catch up, more a chance to get out of the way. So you've given the leading cars at least one clear lap when we go racing again. But of course, as I say, it all eats into the time remaining, 13 minutes on the clock. Out of the chicane, turns 14 and 15. There is the safety car now lagging back, probably on instruction, because the back markers are not that far up the road, really. So through they come once again. It is rare that you see the safety car go quite so slowly. Normally, the safety car goes quickly because it can go quicker than a full course yellow delta speed and therefore help drivers get tyre temperatures and pressures to a safe operating level. But right now, it's having to wait for the traffic. So Amaury Bonduel leads the way. Safety car will be in this lap. And Bonduel might be able to pull away, but I suspect it will do him little good, given that the pit stop was so short compared to the regulation time. So we're on lap 19. Safety car in this lap. And then we will be back racing. There is the leader. So that is Amaury Bonduel, 6 times a karting champion. He's raced in the 24-8 series. He's raced in the Ultimate Cup. He's raced in single-seaters, Italian F4 up to GP3 level through Formula Renault. So he's an experienced driver all round now, like many, sort of trying to kickstart a career through GT racing. And if you get some good results in Lamborghini Super Trofeo, get on that young driver program, then of course that is also going to help to try and be a catalyst for your future. So now you can see, as the safety car has slowed right down, the field all bunching up, and so we will be back in business. But this accident, I'm afraid to say, is going to delay things even more. Piling into the traffic is Pier Felligioni, and that's going to be another car or two stranded by the side of the circuit. The leader's pit stop time is under investigation, and those two cars surely can't be left where they are, and that means that the safety car period is going to be elongated. I think it was Holger Harmsen's car that was driven into. So the plan was that the safety car would be in this time, but I think the lights are back on. Yeah, they are. So Alain Adon throws up his hands in horror or something like that and has to instruct the safety car team to stay out for at least one more lap because there's another two cars. Now, we only had one to move initially, now we've got two. And that was partly caused by the cars slowing under the safety car and Pier Felligioni getting into the back of the traffic. So let's have another look. How he managed to do that, I don't know, because he could see the cars ahead. He knew he was catching and just piled into the back of number 90, Holger Harmsen's car. So that, I suspect, also is going to be something that the officials have a look at post-race, because to do that under the safety car is really not acceptable. So Pier Felligioni will have to explain himself, having gone into the back of Holger Harmsen's car. So the field is currently on lap 20. The reason for this safety car period is officially described as rescue at the exit of turn 5. It is our second safety car period of the race, and an elongated one at that, as the cars then turn through. And Amaury Bonduel, I think I'd said his pit stop time is under investigation. Well, it'll presumably be a time penalty at the end of the race, and this safety car period doing him no favours at all, because he's just got no chance to build a gap at all. So two cars to be retrieved. There is one of the course vehicles. But it's got to go backwards up the grass. This is Yeah, I'm a bit fearful for how many laps we're going to get in here, because with only 8¾ minutes on the clock, this might even take us to the very end of the race. And instead of restarting, we might not get a restart. And that was all largely because of Felagioni's incident. So, lap 20. Anne-Marie Bonduelle leads on the road. Max Wearing, more than likely, is the man that's going to take the win now, with Laura Spinelli on those corrected times. So here it is again. So the traffic slows, cars scatter, and Felagioni sort of, you see him jink one way and then the other, as though he was trying to work out which way to go, and committed in the end to just piling into the back of Holger Harmsen. But it was the traffic ahead of Harmsen. There was another car, wasn't there, that had got slightly caught out, went to the right onto the grass. Holger Harmsen went to the left, and Felagioni went into the back of him. So that's the reason that these two cars are being retrieved. The safety car brings Anne-Marie Bonduelle over the timing line. 7½ minutes to go. Still the clock ticks down. And so right now, a lap is nearly 3 minutes. So even only if it were only one lap behind the safety car now, we'd only end up with 4 minutes. And if it's two laps behind the safety car, we'll be lucky to get a racing lap in. So as the field turns through, quick look at class leaders. Pro-Am, this is all helping Sandro Mür and Martin Kodrich, because they're keeping at bay Emmanuel Colombini. And Emmanuel is on Zini's car, as down the pit lane has just come Filippo Berto. But down to third in Pro-Am has dropped Massimo Ciglia and Lewis Williamson. So they were, of course, second in class earlier on. Their pit stop was a 1:38.9 as against Colombini's 1:28, so they lost 10 seconds in the pits, and they've lost a place that they might not be able to get back now. In the AM contest, Andre Lewandowski is ahead of Louis Wagner, ahead of Gabriel Rindoni, and in the Lamborghini Cup, there is the leader. Francois Grimm is ahead of Gerard Vanderhorst, and then Daniel Vashinsky, who's also under investigation for a speeding into the pit lane offence. Nothing, though, has come, as far as I'm aware, about number six, the car of Jean-Luc Daria, for chopping the pit exit white line that we had seen. But that may also be looked at post-race, we'll see. So, the safety car comes through. This is the run down towards turn 10. Lights are still on. And we're looking at about 3 minutes to a safety car lap. So, at best, we're going to get one lap in here. But really, really frustrating that the majority of this second stint has been under the safety car, because the drivers were allowed to get through the pit window. Then the car in question, Filippo Berto's entry, brought from the gravel. And now we've had this extra problem. Right, a drive-through penalty for Pierre Felagioni. Well, it doesn't matter to him because he's out of the race. But also Anne-Marie Bonduelle converted to a 30-second time penalty for too short a pit stop. So, doesn't matter by what you are under. If you're under, you get a drive-through, and because there isn't time to serve that, it's a 30-second penalty. So with the field all bunched up like this, 30 seconds for the leader is going to drop him down into 21st place. So Bonduelle,
safety car in this lap,
says a weary race director. So Anne-Marie Bonduelle looking to be 20th at best, I think, here. So we will go racing this time, fingers crossed, and that will give us at least one lap. Hopefully we might squeeze two out of it in a slightly unsatisfactory second stint, given that extra accident that we had behind the safety car. So Pierre Felagioni, first of all, gets a penalty for being too short on the pit stop, which he can't serve, but is probably going to be up before the beak anyway for driving into people under the safety car. However, up front, Anne-Marie Bonduelle needs to try to break away as best he can. He won't win the race, but every second he can pull away from the pack means he might be able to gain a place, and we'll see where it will ultimately drop him to. fans already. Then they've had a rather long wait to see race action again in this second part of the opening race of the weekend in Lamborghini Super Trofeo, which will finish in November in Portimao, the first weekend, with qualifying on the Thursday, racing the doubleheader for Europe on the Friday, and then Saturday and Sunday, the regular format given over to the World Finals. So the safety car absolutely pressing on. Amaury Bonduelle going with him. And Max Wearing in second place, just driving to the end now because he will have got the message about Bonduelle's pit stop penalty. So as long as he brings the car home ahead of Moretti, yet another win, he's going to go their way. And this would be a seventh victory for the pair of them. So Amaury Bonduelle brings the field then up towards turn 12. Now, interestingly, he's backed off here rather than go thundering away. But Max Wearing doesn't want to get anywhere near him. He's quite happy to lead his own race up to the end. So good teamwork here by the Bernardi crew, telling Max Wearing the situation, saying
green
ignore
flag,
that car.
Green flag.
Green flag called for by the race director. We've got 2.5 minutes on the clock. A race flying lap is just under 2 minutes, so we should get two more laps out of the race as Bonduelle accelerates away. Wearing, though, is the real race leader. And then Marzio Moretti has got to get himself up through the traffic. He's going to get past Fry, but they're side by side. Emmanuel Colombini goes through to take over the lead of Pro-Am now. So Emmanuel Colombini on the outside line goes through. Marzio Moretti on the inside, a bit of a snake under braking there on his coldish tyres from Max Wearing. Moretti looking a lot more planted. So let's now see what Moretti can do against Wearing. The margin between them was 1.4 seconds. More battles lower down there. Jean-Luc Daria goes through. He's trying to get himself up through the pack as well. And Massimo Ciglia, number 27, likewise trying to fight back within the Pro-Am category. So Amaury Bonduelle tries now to get away as best he can. Where's the next battle going to come from? To the inside line there, dives Lennart Marionnec, and he goes through. That's only to lap, though, Oliver Freimuth. So number 24, a lap down. That's the sort of spoiler in the pack, in a way, here, because people need to negotiate him before they can really get on with their own battles. The former Renault and Porsche one-mate racer, Oliver Freimuth, who's been another Super Trofeo stalwart these last few seasons, and he, in turn, is now being chased by Hans Fabry in number 88, another of the Lamborghini Cup entries is Hans Fabry. Down to turn 10, last lap beckons, and for many a last chance to make progress. Bronek Formanek there goes through, also the sister car, number 22, getting out of the way. We've got more strife down at turn 7, another one in the gravel. And that is delayed, Stefan Gerhardt, but there's another car that has brought out a yellow flag then. So as the field comes through, Cedric Limer, number 63, has had another spin by the look of it. So Limer off the road and hopefully can get going. But we should be on the last lap anyway now. So it is Bonduelle leading on the road, but we'll see in a moment what 20 seconds will do to drop him down the field. But Max Wearing leads the way on corrected times. More bodywork flies coming out of the chicane because there's another concertina effect there. Part of this is quick drivers trying to get on with the programme and get through the traffic at the same time. Number 6, Jean-Luc Daria goes through. He's got himself up now past Bronek Formanek. And Sandro Mer there, number 32, leads in Pro-Am, but not for long, I don't think. Daria is in a different class. So 32, Sandro Mer versus number 66 of Bronek Formanek versus 78 of Emmanuel Colombini. And Formanek's about to have a go on the inside there. Sandro Mer closes the door, but Formanek forces a way through, and he's done it then. So Bronek Formanek goes through, up into the lead of Pro-Am at the expense of Sandro Mer. Number 78, Emmanuel Colombini comes diving up the inside there, goes through. Nips past Donovan Privitelio, the son of the father and son, dad and lad partnership. But Pro-Am is all kicking off on this last lap, and Sandro Mer losing places. Up front, though, Max Wearing set for the race win. And there, heading uphill once more, is number 71. So on the attack there, that is Eduardo Liberati. He took over early from Martin Reiber. And pushing on now as the cars dive down towards turn 10. Under attack, more contact, and that's turned around Colombini by the look of it. Others have to scatter in avoidance. So That's going to change the order again within the Pro-Am fight. We'll try and unravel this when they get to the line. That is the car that's going to win on corrected times then, because up towards the line, Amaury Bonduelle takes the chequered flag, but the race winner will be number 61, Max Wearing and Loris Spinelli. There they are then to take the chequered flag first. And it's Marzio Moretti in second place. The gap at the end, 1.3 seconds between them. Third is going to be Kyle Witts and Mario Netz. The rest of the field come pouring through with the first Pro-Am car home being Bronek Formanek and Carol Bash. Second, Eduardo Liberati and Martin Reimer. And third, Gerhard Watzinger and Brendan Leach. Gerhard Watzinger's name shown all the way through that race, so whether or not Brendan Leach drove, we'll find out when they get to the podium potentially. But for Amaury Bonduelle, he wins on the road, but 20 seconds actually is only going to drop him, I would offer you, to sixth place. It could have been a whole lot worse. Part of that was because of all the skirmishes on the last lap of the race. Sandro Mir ending up in 20th place, and Colin Beeney 29th, having been turned around down at turn 10 on that last lap. So Max Wearing brings the car back to pit lane. I'm wondering why he's driving so wide on these laps, on this lap in. It's so he can make sure that the car has lots of pickup, which will help for the ride height, help for the weight, and therefore get him easily through the technical checks. Not for a moment suggesting that the car is in any way wrong, but it's just normal practice from drivers to make sure that the weight, the ride height is all there. Teams await then in pit lane, where they will start the celebrations. We'll have the four classes, of course, from that race. So, quick look at the race result, provisionally. Max Wearing and Loris Spinelli take honours from Milan Tikkens and Marzio Moretti, with Daniel Karlowitz and Marionette Lennart taking third place. Jean-Luc Daria and Stefan Tribodini finally get some good luck. They finish fourth ahead of the Pro-Am winners, Bronek Formanek and Carol Bash. Rodrigo Testa de Sousa sixth ahead of Martin Reiber and Eduardo Liberati, second in Pro-Am. Eighth, Sebastian Freimuth. Ninth, Gerhard Watzinger and Brendan Leach, third in Pro-Am ahead of Dan Wells and Oscar Lee. And only 11th in the end, Massimo Ciglia and Lewis Williamson. So what did that give them? Fifth in class, where they were running second early on. Big disappointment, given the relative pace of both drivers behind them in the AM contest. 12th was where Andrei Lewandowski finished to win it from 97, which was the car of Louis and Yuri Wagner. And third in Pro-Am, Gabriel Rindoni. The winner of the Lamborghini Cup was Francois Grimm from Gerard Vanderhorst, and then Daniel Vashinsky coming home for third place. But Emmanuel Colombini can be mighty frustrated that he was tagged sideways on that last lap, because 29th is where his car fell to. And Jean-Francois Bruno and Kerong Lee from their pit lane start 32nd. But it's a happy Bonaldi team that can celebrate the race win. Max Wearing then switched teams. It was the Johan Kral Motorsport team last year. This year, as you see, he's gone to the Bonaldi Equipe, and successfully so as well. So, a very, very happy squad. Celebrations are underway all up and down the pit lane. The Bonaldi team, as I've been saying, one of those squads that's run in the championship for so many seasons. So, Max Wearing, Loris Spinelli, well clear in the overall championship. Amaury Bonduelle second, and then Marzio Moretti and Milan Tikkens third. But had they had more racing laps, could have been a different story potentially for them. But it was not to be. So the drivers will shortly go to the podium. A big, big cheer, because I think that is probably done enough now to give Loris Spinelli and Max Wearing the overall title. And even in the pro class, they're going to be hard to be caught, but provisionally I would say that makes them the overall champions already, even with three races to go, because the margin they've got is just a vast one. But even so, that is a seventh victory of the season, and a well-earned one as well. They've made a great combination, those two. And the wins that started coming last year keep on coming. So bravo to Max Wearing and Loris Spinelli. Now, let's hear from our race winners. Loris Spinelli and Max Wearing are with Gemma Scott.
Max, Loris, that was absolutely fantastic. It was a bit like watching Mario Kart on those last few laps.
Yeah, it was quite difficult, but I had to play with my mind and having a look what I had to do. The car was vibrating a lot, and there was a small trouble, but next to that, I only had to push for two laps, and we are quite happy. He made it. He did an amazing job again, and the team did an amazing job again. Now we are here, finally.
Absolutely, a fantastic result. Loris, did you have the vibration and the problem the whole way through your stint as well?
Yeah, I mean, the difficult part of today was just to manage the tire, because the track today is really hot. So I tried just to do my best. The car was really good, really strong, as all the weekend. So really thanks to my team, to Bonaldi, and maybe for this championship, no?
Yeah, I think you might well have done enough there. I've not had it confirmed to me yet, but that certainly put you in very, very good stead.
Thank you.
Well done.
Thank you.
So top job by champions elect, I think we can call them, can't we? Max Wearing and Loris Spinelli. And the fact that the Bonaldi mechanics were all out to celebrate as well rather suggests that they know that they've done enough. But to win it so early, that is quite an achievement, I tell you. So there, the photographs taken, the cheers echo, and hugs all round. Top stuff from the Bonaldi Motorsport team. Loris Spinelli, yet another win to go with his impressive CV from Lamborghini Racing, having been the 2018 Pro-Am champion in Europe and in the World Finals, the 2017 European champion, the 2015 Pro-Am champion in Europe as well, and another title going his way this season. So, podium beckons. Let's look at the highlights of that race then. It began with a demon start by Loris Spinelli to catapult himself clear of the opposition on the way down towards turn one. Martin Kodrich going through on the inside line to pick up second spots. But around that opening lap of the race, there was drama. Cedric Limer getting himself in strife and being turned around. So as that car fell down the order, others picking up penalties as the race went on included Rodrigo Testa de Sousa, who got a 5-second penalty for causing a collision and therefore fell out of the top six. In the classes, cars ran side by side in the early laps as Loris Spinelli tried to build his lead. Then we had this little mistake from Pietro Parolini that put him off the racetrack. Milan Petelet went diving through, gained ground, but then Petelet was also given a penalty for an earlier indiscretion. Loris Spinelli led as he came into the pit lane. Hans Fabry's slower car just ahead of him, serving its regulation pit stop, and they got very close to making contact as Spinelli braked at the very last possible moment. Then we had to have the safety car while Filippo Berto's Oregon entry was hooked out of the gravel. And more contact when the race got back underway. On the last lap, another sort out down at turn 10. And Emmanuel Colombini turfed out of the top six. He fell way, way down the order as through for the race win came Loris Spinelli and Max Wearing, their seventh of the season. And the championship is theirs for the taking. So the cars all underneath the podium. The cars you can see driving down the pit lane are those for the next race for the GT4 European Series. Their pit stop race coming up shortly here at a busy Barcelona circuit. This GT festival that Jesus Puzo and his team has put together once more. And the first podium is going to be for the outright result. So the drivers will be called forward in a moment onto the podium. There's still quite a bit to be looked at, I suspect, as a legacy of that race, but it might be that the story is concluded tomorrow. Jeroen Mull, one of the Lamborghini factory drivers, standing down in the pit lane as Daniel Karlowitz and Lennart Marinetz will be called forward in a moment. So out come Daniel Karwitz and Lennart Marionetsch. They've raced against each other in the German GT Championship for a number of seasons, now partnering in Lamborghini. Marzio Moretti and Milan Tikan step forward for second place. They come onto the podium, which is, if you haven't spotted yet, shaped like the circuit. It's quite a funky podium, that, rather than the boring, usual standard shape. And for the top step of the podium, out come race winners and champions-elect. Max Wearing, Loris Spinelli win race one of Lamborghini Super Trofeo Europe here at the Circuit de Catalunya this weekend. For the Bonaldi Motorsport team, they stand on the top step of the podium. Yet another win for Max Wearing and Loris Spinelli. I think a national anthem was anticipated, but maybe the band forgot the tune. Either way, it's a happy podium, lots of thumbs up, lots of smiles, and in the absence of an anthem, I think maybe the trophies are next. So there are the drivers, Max Wearing, Loris Spinelli for the top step, Milan Tikan and Marzio Moretti second place, and newcomers to the championship, Daniel Karwitz and Lennart Marionetsch. A really good start to their involvement in Lamborghini Super Trofeo. They take then that third place. So the anthem for the winning team finally rings out at the Circuit de Catalunya, and then the trophies to be presented to drivers then. And their race winners' trophy from Federico Foschini, the chief marketing and sales officer. He will present to the top three drivers, top three combinations. As I say, Daniel Karwitz and Lennart Marionetsch are good. Debut in the championship. Then for second place, Marzio Moretti and Milan Tikans. And once more, Max Wearing and Loris Spinelli claim the top spot on the podium, and yet another race win. So one more race to look forward to tomorrow in Lamborghini Super Trofeo. Congratulations to Max Wearing and Loris Spinelli. And race two should be just as lively when we're back in Barcelona tomorrow. Bye for now.